Now we are going to start tumors of the oral cavity. The tumors which occur in the oral cavity, they may be classified into three main groups: benign tumors, pre-malignant lesions, and the malignant tumors. The benign tumors are further subdivided into solid tumors and cystic tumors, whereas the malignant tumors can be classified into two, that is the carcinoma and non-squamous malignant tumors. First, we take up the benign tumors. The benign tumors, as I have said, they are solid ones or the cystic ones. The solid tumors are papilloma, fibroma, hemangioma, lymphangioma, torus, pyogenic granuloma, pregnancy granuloma, and minor salivary gland tumors, for example, pleomorphic adenoma. The cystic tumors which appear in the oral cavity are mucosal, granula, and the dermoid. The pre-malignant lesions which occur in the oral cavity are erythroleukoplakia, melanosis, and mucosal hyperpigmentation. The malignant tumors. Among the malignant tumors are, number one, squamous cell carcinoma. This is the most commonly malignant tumor which occurs in the oral cavity, around about 85%. The other are minor salivary gland malignant tumors, which are only 5%. For example, adenoid cystic carcinoma, adenocarcinoma, mucoepidermoid carcinoma. Other malignant tumors are malignant melanoma. The incidence is only 0.1%. Lymphoma, especially the non-Hodgkin's type, which is around about 1%. And the last one is the Kaposi sarcoma. First, we take up the benign tumors. Papilloma. Papilloma is a finger-like benign growth arising from the mucosa of the oral cavity. The most common sites where the papilloma make its appearance are soft palate, hard palate, uvula, tongue, and lips. The size of the papilloma is usually less than 1 centimeter. The clinical features are, number one, pedunculated finger-like growth appearing in the oral cavity. The color of the lesion is white. Usually the surface is irregular, but sometimes it may be smooth surface as well. The treatment for papilloma is excisional biopsy. Now, this is the photograph showing you the papilloma. You can see here the papilloma is having an irregular surface. Second benign tumor in the oral cavity is the hemangioma. Hemangioma is a benign tumor of the blood vessels. Actually, this is malformation of the blood vessels, mostly seen in the children. It can appear in three types. It may be capillary hemangioma, cavernous hemangioma, and mixed variety. This is the hemangioma present in the oral cavity affecting the hard palate. Actually, the gingiva, they are affected just behind the upper incisor teeth. This is the hemangiomatous mass arising from the mucosa on the cheek. Treatment. If the hemangioma is present at birth or if it appears in the young children, then we may wait and see because spontaneous regression may occur in majority of the alleles. If there is no regression, then it can be treated by medical treatment or by surgical treatment. The medical treatment consists of propranolol, which is a beta blocker. The dose recommended is 1 to 2 milligrams per day in 3 divided doses for 1 year to 1.5 year period. This propranolol, it may cause vasoconstriction of the blood vessels of the infantile hemangioma. It reduces the growth factors which are responsible for the growth of the vessels, and it also may promote the apoptosis responsible for reduction in size of the hemangioma. Apart from medical treatment, one can inject hot water injection into the lesion. Sometimes sclerotherapy with sclerosing agent may be tried and it may be successful to treat the hemangioma. Laser surgery may be advised. Cryosurgery may sometimes be advised to treat the hemangioma. And the last one is the surgical excision and histopathology. If hemangioma is large one, or if it is persistent or progressive, then there are certain surgical procedures which can be performed to deal with these hemangioma. One is surgical excision and followed by repair of the defect. Second, laser surgery. Third, cryosurgery. Fourth, sclerotherapy with sclerosing agent. Fifth, microembolization of the bleeding of the feeding blood vessels. And last one is the microembolization of the feeding blood vessels and then surgical excision of the tumor. Torus. Torus is a benign submucosal bony growth. The usual sites for the torus formation are, number one is the hard palate. In this case, the term is known as torus palatinus. This is more common as compared to the other one, that is the mandible torus. Clinically, the torus palatinus, it may present as a narrow bony ridge in the oral cavity on the hard palate. Secondly, it may appear as a solitary nodule, or sometimes there may be a lobulated mass in the midline of the hard palate. This is the photograph showing the torus palatinus. You can see a hard lobulated mass present in the hard palate area in the oral cavity. Then the mandibular torus. These are bilateral bony outgrowths present on the lingual aspect of the mandible. Treatment for the torus is surgical resection of the torus with a gouge and hammer, or sometimes you may drill the torus with a bar. This surgical treatment is needed if the torus interferes with, number one, speech, mastication, or if there is history of fitting of dentures. So in these indications, you can remove the torus surgically. This is the photograph of mandibular tori. You can see on the lingual aspect of the floor of mouth, you can of the mandible, there are two bony outgrowths. Ranula. Ranula is a term which has been derived from the Latin word rana, meaning frog, as the swelling of ranula resembles the frog's belly. It is a cystic translucent swelling which is usually found in the floor of the mouth on one side of the frenulum. etiology for the formation of ranula is not clearly understood. Some theories are, number one, trauma to the duct of the sublingual salivary gland. Second theory is that sometimes trauma to the duct of the minor salivary gland may lead to ranula formation. And third one is defect in the ducts of the salivary glands. The salivary gland may be minor one or it may be a major salivary gland, for example, sublingual salivary gland. When there is stenosis of the duct, then it may lead to formation of ranula. There are two types of ranula. Number one is the simple ranula, second is the plunging ranula. The clinical features in a simple ranula: the simple ranula remains confined to the floor of the mouth and presents as a cystic, translucent, benign swelling in the floor of mouth on one side of the ranula. Whereas in a case of plunging ranula, it results from extravasation of mucus below the myelohead muscle and presents in the neck as a painless and cystic swelling. So you can see that the simple ranula remains confined to the floor of mouth above the myelohead muscle, whereas the plunging ranula will present when there is extravasation of mucus below the myelohead muscle. This is the photograph showing the ranula in the floor of mouth on the right side of the ranula. This is a patient having a swelling in the neck. This is plunging ranula. This is the CT scan of the head and neck, sagittal or parasagittal view, showing you a plunging ranula shadow in the submental region, which is indicated by the arrow. Treatment is, if the ranula is small one, then you can remove it by surgical excision, because it is having a very thin wall and also it may have its ramifications in the various tissue planes. In majority of the cases, the wall of the ranula ruptures and the mucus is drained up. So in this case, if the ranula ruptures, then all the walls of the ranula must be removed. Otherwise, recurrence is very common. If the ranula is large one, then the surgeon may perform marsupialization. If the patient is having plunging ranula, then excision of the ranula is performed by performing transverse skin crease incision. So surgical excision is the answer for the treatment of ranula, whether it is simple ranula or it is a plunging ranula. Dermoid. Dermoids are benign cystic malformations lined with squamous epithelium. As far as the prevalence of dermoids in the head and neck region is concerned, it is around about 7%, whereas in the oral cavity, the incidence is 1.6%. We can divide the dermoids into three types depending upon the tissue which is present in them. Number one is the epidermoid cyst, second is the true dermoid cyst, third one is the pteridoid cyst. In epidermoid cyst, this is lined with simple squamous epithelium. The true dermoid cyst, this cyst is lined with skin adnexa in its wall. The pteridoid cyst will contain muscle, cartilage, and bone. In the head and neck, two types of dermoids are seen. Number one is the sublingual dermoid, Second one is the submental dermoid. In case of sublingual dermoid, there is a median or a lateral swelling in the floor of mouth above the myeloid muscle. And it will shine through the mucosa as a white mass in the contrast to the translucent nature of the ranula. So this is the main difference between the dermoid and the ranula. In submental dermoid, it develops below the myeloid muscle and presents as a midline submental swelling behind the chin in the neck. And it will give a double chin appearance in the patient. This is the photograph showing sublingual dermoid in the floor of mouth. And this is the dermoid seen in the submental region in the neck. You can see the patient is having a double chin appearance in the neck. As far as the investigations are concerned, FNSE, CT scan, MRI, and axial biopsy for histopathology, these are the investigations which may be asked in these patients. Treatment is complete surgical excision of the dermoid. Then, now we discuss the pre-malignant lesions of the oral cavity. Number one is the leukoplakia. Leukoplakia is a white patch or plaque on the mucosal surface of the oral cavity. 2 to 3 or even sometimes more mucosal surfaces may be involved in around about 70% of the cases. If we examine the leukoplakic plaque or patch under the microscope, we can have hyperkeratosis, parakeratosis, or sometimes varying degree of dysplasia from mild to severe in histopathological lesions. Now, what is hyperkeratosis? Hyperkeratosis means increased number of keratinized layers of the skin or mucosa. Normally, there are 3 to 4 layers only. In hyperkeratosis, the number of layers will be increased. Parakeratosis means retention of nuclei in the keratinized layers of the skin or mucosa. Normally, there are no nuclei in the keratinized layers. As far as the dysplasia is concerned, dysplasia means disorganized arrangement of the cells. It is a pre-malignant condition. Then the last one is the carcinoma in situ. This condition is said when the malignant cells are present but not involving the basement membrane. So these are the different types of terms which are usually used when we describe some pre-malignant lesions. Now this is the photograph showing you the leukoplakia involving the cheek. In this photograph, you can see the tip of the tongue and some part of the lateral border and dorsum of the tongue is involved. Sides of leukoplakia. In a decreasing order, buccal mucosa, this is the commonest site to be involved in leukoplakia. Second is the alveolar mucosa, then tongue, lip, palate, floor of mouth, and gingiva. So any part of the oral cavity may be involved in leukoplakia, but the commonest site is the buccal mucosa. Etiology, or you can say the risk factors which are involved to cause the leukoplakia are, number one is the smoking. This is the most important risk factor. Second is the chewing of tobacco or palm. And third, keeping tobacco or snuff quit in the vestibule of the mouth. These are the some of the risk factors which may lead to leukoplakia lesion. Clinical variants of leukoplakia. Number one is the leukoplakia simplex. second varicose leukoplakia, and third one is the erythroleukoplakia. Erythroplakia. Erythroplakia is a red patch or plaque on the mucosal surface of the oral cavity. Red color indicates decreased keratinization, and so red vascular connective tissue of the submucosa shines through. Incidence of malignant change is very high in erythroplakia as compared to the leukoplakia, but both are pre-malignant conditions. Now you can see here the reddish mucosa. This is due to erythroplakia. Then the third term, that is the erythroleukoplakia. This is an oral mucosal lesion which appears as a red velvety plaque. It may show an irregular mixture of white and red areas. This is the most dangerous lesion, and it is the most likely to become malignant. You can see on the cheek that there are mixture of erythroplakia mixed with leukoplakia. So these conditions may be termed as erythroleukoplakia. Management of pre-malignant lesions. So these lesions which have been described, they can be managed by taking proper history and history of some risk factors, for example, pan, tobacco, smoking, etc. Then examination of the lesion, then biopsy from the area of active disease, then definite treatment according to the lesion. When the histopathology report comes, the surgeon will treat that condition according to the lesion. The usual scheme is that if the biopsy is negative, then the patient may be discharged from the ward, but follow-up is very, very important in these patients. If biopsy report shows leukoplakia or erythroleukoplakia, then excision biopsy with at least 5 millimeter safe margin is taken. The tissue is sent for histopathology to confirm diagnosis and left the area to granulate itself. Or sometimes you may cover the area with a split skin graft. Or sometimes laser excision may be performed. Secondly, the patient is advised to avoid all the risk factors. And vigilant follow-up is very important in head and neck region clinic to know whether the patient is having recurrence of the lesion or not. On the other hand, if biopsy is positive for carcinoma, then examination under anesthesia is mandatory. Secondly, CT scan and MRI and other possible important tests are done. And then, according to the histopathology report, definite treatment is started. Thank you for listening and watching.